This is important. Select the most appropriate sensors for various applications. Select the right sensor for the particular application. Yeah? Having good understanding of sensor performance and having good understanding of environment, the real world in which this sensor will operate. In other words, understanding environmental parameters, because environmental parameters, sensors should not respond to environmental parameters. Sensors should be insensitive to surrounding temperature, yeah? If I am measuring, for instance, carbon monoxide concentration, I want the output signal to be dependent only on carbon monoxide concentration, not to be dependent partly on surrounding temperature or on humidity or earth magnetic field for some sensors or vibrations or electromagnetic interference. Yeah? It should respond only. Not only this. During the plenary talk I mentioned selectivity. Selectivity, big issue. Yeah? Sensors should respond only to target analyte, carbon monoxide concentration. So good understanding of environmental parameters is crucial. It's crucial. Because laboratory world, when we are developing sensors at the university laboratory, they are nice conditions. Yeah? We are keeping temperature under control, humidity in a gas chamber under control. There is well shielded, no electromagnetic interference. Yeah? And other parameters are under control. But in the real world, different story. Different story. University laboratory is a virtual world. But real world is different. So now we will discuss, we'll have good understanding of these basic terms. I need a help because I'm not familiar with this computer. We have to go to Alejandro to
Okay.
So, definitions, terminology, classification. We are widely using both terms, sensors and transducers, but I already mentioned there is a different understanding of these terms in Europe and in the United States. And probably the same story in Mexico, yeah? I don't know which sort of understanding you are using.
We will read literature from all over the world.
Yeah. Because there is a lot of mess in this business, and we have to be very precise, very accurate. So, the choice of words in science is very important. Now, the word sensor is derived from the Latin language, sentire, meaning to perceive, and transducer is from transducere, meaning to lead across. We'll go to the, I will explain this in a second. Now, dictionary definition, Chambers, 20th century. Sensor is a device that detects a change in a physical stimulus and turns it into a signal which can be measured or recorded. So they put only physical stimulus, but it could be chemical or could be biochemical stimulus, yeah? External stimulus, detects, responds to external stimulus. Transducer is the device that transfers power from one system to another, or the same in a different form. So, sensible distinction is to use sensor as a, to understand the term sensor as a sensing element itself, sensing element itself. And transducer for the sensing element plus signal processing system. When we are using thermocouple, everybody is familiar with thermocouple, yeah? Thermocouple senses temperature. But thermocouple plus signal processing system is a transducer. But, at the same time, we have a different understanding of these terms in a chemical and biosensing field. I will show you. Let's put this as a gas sensitive layer. Gas sensitive layer. Composed of nanomaterial with certain morphology. So this layer will interact with gas molecules. We are interested in a device with electrical output signal. Only electrical output signal. So we are limiting our considerations to electrical output signal because it could be also non-electrical output signal, that's right. Probably young people have seen these old style meters which are currently in museums mainly. Yeah? Deflection, voltmeter, amperometer. This is also transducer, yeah? Output signal is a mechanical deflection. Mechanical deflection. We are limiting our considerations only to the class of devices with electrical output signal. So, nanomaterial. Let's put input value. For instance, carbon monoxide concentration. I need electrical output signal. I have to use proper physical transducer. As a result, I have electrical output signal, like for instance, resistance change, voltage change, current change, or frequency change. And all this stuff, in this case, look, we call sensor. You understand the mess, yeah? This, in the gas sensing field, we have different understanding than according to these definitions. The same story with biosensing. If there is an immobilized layer of, let's say, antibodies, and I'm going to measure the corresponding amount of antigens, I'm using the proper biological layer, I'm using physical transducer, and in total, this is biosensor. But in this case, this is a gas sensor. So we have to be very careful because people in different areas have a different understanding. In different geographic zones and in different areas of knowledge, they have a different understanding of this term, sensor and transducer. And as I said, the oldest conference in the world, transducers. Thermistor is a good example. Thermistor is a device to measure temperature. Thermistor output signal is a resistance change. Usually it operates in a Wheatstone bridge because it's located in one of the arms of the Wheatstone bridge. So we have a sensing element as a thermistor plus Wheatstone bridge to get the voltage output signal is a sensor. So again, it's not compatible with this situation. We have to avoid mess. We have to have a good understanding. Now, tell me please, when you are looking at these output signals, resistance, voltage, current, frequency, which one do you prefer? Which one is the best? Everybody thinks, yeah? It's much easier for me to think because I drink coffee. This is engineering approach. Very specific question. Which parameter is preferable? Everybody thinks. And why? Why? Let me put this question in a different way. Which quantity could be measured most accurately? Krishna, help me. Most accurately? Krishna, are you an electronic engineer? Most accurately?
I'm not an electronic engineer, but perhaps frequency.
Excellent. Look, all these people, I tell you something, when I'm attending International Congress and someone is standing up and saying like this, I am not an expert in this field, but I would like to ask you a question. My back is frozen immediately because I know very well that it's easy to communicate with expert, yeah? Easy. Non-expert usually asks very tough questions. They are saying, I don't understand it, but I would like to ask you a question. Always dangerous situation.
I'm really not an engineer.
Yeah. Look. My role is to try to teach you sensor thinking, because this is very specific way of thinking. Dr. Olvera replied correctly, because during the first hour I said the simplicity is the higher level of refinement, yeah? So from the simplicity point of view, we can measuring resistance is simple, yeah? Simple. But from accuracy point of view, frequency is preferable because I can measure frequency very accurately. It's not simple. Somebody could say, well, I can measure resistance and use the signal processing. As a result, at the end of the chain, I will have a frequency output signal, yeah? I can, but I need a signal processing. Few blocks to transfer resistance change into frequency change. So both replies are correct, but again, depends what I want to achieve. Now, the next question. If I am measuring resistance, Everybody knows that molybdenum trioxide is excellent semiconducting metal oxide to measure gas concentration, yeah? But it has one big disadvantage, that resistance is usually very high. Very high. Let's say in the range of sometimes tens of megaohms. Tens of megaohms. It is easy to measure 10 megaohms or 100 megaohms. It is not. It's difficult. Why is difficult? Why is difficult?
Because you need a special equipment.
Because we need to shielding, proper shielding, yeah? Because high resistance could act as an antenna. As an antenna. If we are working in the area, in the real world, where there are many electromagnetic interferences, this will collect these small signals, and part of our output signal will come from electromagnetic interference, not from the particular gas concentration. That's right? So it is not so easy. Now, my simple question is, when we are dealing with resistance, with which resistance change is the most acceptable, the most preferable? Electronic engineer will help me, which range is much easier to measure?
Low resistance.
Low, okay, low, but low, could you be specific?
Yes, ohms.
One ohm? No. 1 ohm? No. Yeah, because the resistance of connection wires, yeah, could spoil my measurement. So, let's say 100 megaohms, not good. 1 ohm, not good. So something, let's say, between 100 ohms and 1 kilo ohm. This is ideal situation, yeah? So everything depends. Again, look, compromise, delta R, delta F, compromise. If accuracy is needed, delta F is preferable. If the simplicity is needed, resistance measurements are the best. That's right? That's right. Now, voltage, some physical transducers, nature is like this, that Schottky, let me be specific. Schottky metal junction has the same characteristic, current voltage characteristic, like ordinary PN junction, that's right? So we have a situation like this. This is a forward bias. This is voltage. So we have this forward bias and reverse bias. I can use constant current mode of operation. Constant current. Yeah. And if due to the physicochemical processes occurring on the surface, because of the interaction of gas molecules with a gas sensitive layer, this characteristic will shift. This is my output signal, yeah? Let's say due to the 1% of hydrogen. Constant current mode of operation. This is the output signal. First approach, when I'm dealing with any type of sensor. First approach is to think like this. What is the transfer characteristic? What is the transfer characteristic? Output-input relationship. I have no deep knowledge of the sensor, but I'm thinking, what is the output signal? What is the input signal? So I'm using this black box, and putting like this. Hydrogen concentration, and what is the output voltage? Well, output signal, for instance, it could be delta R. So this is the first question I have to ask. Transfer characteristic, output-input relationship, or calibration. People using different terms, calibration. So the complexity, I have to always think in a in a more complex way. Sensing process in terms of energy conversion, because any sensing process is an energy conversion. That's right? Input energy, output energy. Input energy, output energy. I'm using this general term transducer. Transducer. But again, remember that in chemical and biosensing, different understanding. And remember, Europe and US, different understanding. So, types of transducers. We have many types of transducers, and Germans are very good in classification because they are always, because of their national character, they would like to classify everything. Yeah? Everything should be classified. Everything should be in order. This is the German term Ordnung. Yeah? Ordnung. This is crucial. We have different types of energy in sensor technology use: radiant, gravitational, mechanical, thermal, and so on, so on. And occurrence for the, any each type of energy. Radio waves, for instance, mechanical motion, displacement, forces, molecular binding energy, molecules, and so on, so on. So, types of transducers. Now, each of the forms of the energy has a corresponding signal associated with this, and for measurement purposes, six types of signals are important. Six types. But we are only interested in electrical voltage, current, resistance, dielectric constant could be also employed in sensor technology. Dielectric constant. Capacitive type of sensors. General form of measurement system, input transducer, the six forms of energy, input transducers, modifier, output transducer, and again, output signals. But we are interested only in this class of energy and transducer which changes the form of energy into electrical output signal. The three types of transducers, three types: modifier, self-generator, modulator. So let's see. First one, self-exciting or self-generating. There is no need for external energy. Thermocouple, no need for external energy. Peltier effect. Peltier effect, yeah? Junction, two different metals. Temperature changes due to the Peltier effect. I have an output signal in the form of Krishna. Which form for Peltier effect? Krishna, be alert, alert. Be alert, because any time I could ask a question. For thermocouple, what is the output energy? What is the output signal? Voltage. 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 So the transfer characteristic, black box, here we have a temperature, here we have delta V, yeah? Calibration curve. No need for external energy. No need. In general, they produce very low output energy because it's a low conversion efficiency. So we are not happy with the level of output signal. We have to add signal processing system to increase. We need amplifiers of this sort of electronics, because Peltier effect, the typical sensitivity is, let's say, around 30, 50 microvolts per degree centigrade. So it's a low level of output signal. We need amplifier, yeah? So this is a first type, self-generator. Now, modulator. Modulator, this one, this one. We need a source of energy. The example, photoconductive cells, thermistors, or resistive displacement device. So relatively large flow of electrical energy is controlled by much smaller input signal energy. And the modifying transducers, modifying transducer. This is very interesting type of transducer. Elastic beams or diaphragms. Elastic beams of diaphragm. Let's discuss this for a second because it's a important. Beams, membranes, or cantilevers. Cantilevers. Very powerful transducer for chemical sensing. One of the hot subjects at present is to design cantilever with the silicon carbide substrate and graphene layer on the top. Why? Because, as I said a few days ago, graphene, the use of graphene allows to detect the single molecule of gas. It's extremely sensitive. Why this combination? Because we can fabricate real graphene, it means single layer, single monoatomic layer, easily from silicon carbide. Other methods, people are using now, I said during the first hour, be careful, be critical. Let me give you an example. I found a paper, I was looking if my idea is really novel. I had some idea a couple of days ago, or maybe 2 weeks ago, before coming here. And I was not sure, maybe somebody already did it. So I look at the Google and I found graphene sensor based on photoluminescence quenching. So disappointment, big disappointment. But I went through the paper and I've been relaxed. Why? In the title was graphene. In the abstract, graphite oxide. It was no graphene. They put title with graphene because much easier to be accepted, Much easier, but they did not use graphene. So graphene easily grown from silicon carbide. This is very elegant method of obtaining graphene. So, cantilever. Why cantilever? Let's put this. Cantilever, we can call it beam. Also beam, Widely used in mechanical sensing, Widely used in mechanical sensing, because if we will put force here, we observe deflection, and we can build nice resonant sensor. It means that output signal will be in the form of frequency shift. But I can also build chemical sensor based on this. Because if this is a, let's say, graphene layer, this monoatomic layer here, red one, so this one will be graphene. This one will be silicon carbide, substrate. This device has a resonant characteristic. Resonant characteristic. Let's put it simply like this. There is a frequency. What will happen now? Engineering approach. I know nothing about physical chemistry. I know nothing about graphene. I am ignorant in physical chemistry. I am an ordinary engineer. First approach. What's going on with this? What will happen? What will happen if I would like to measure, for instance, carbon monoxide concentration? Yeah? I functionalize this graphene in a such a way that it will respond to carbon monoxide molecules. That's right? So, engineering approach. What's going on? First, I am building this so-called transduction chain. Transduction chain. First block like this. Here, we have carbon monoxide concentration. This is my input value. Now, what will happen if the carbon monoxide molecules will interact with graphene? What will happen? I know nothing about physical chemistry. Leave physical chemistry. This is El Diablo. I don't want to touch it. Yeah, I know nothing. I am ignorant. I am only ordinary engineer. What will go? What will happen? Everybody thinking, yeah? Because look, again, the same gentleman who is not expert in electronics, yeah? Go ahead, please.
My question is just a step before I ask it. The frequency, the plot that you made there, in Blackwell, I mean, the which frequency is it?
Look. This is mechanical element. This is cantilever or beam is a mechanical element. And at certain circumstances, this element could be act as a resonator. So it's characterized by resonant frequency. Resonant frequency, which is, let's put it at zero. Resonant frequency, yeah?
So you have an antisynthetic.
Say it again.
Do you have a cantilever? You cantilever is in a cantilever?
No. It's in open air.
How do you excite it?
In open air.
Okay. How do you excite?
In open air.
But how do you get that plot?
Mechanical system. Mechanical system could vibrate.
Okay. I see. Thank you.
Do you have a tension or compression?
Yes.
For the
things? It will vibrate. Yeah?
Electrical forces.
Due to the. Okay. Now I understand your question. It's a good question because I tell you something. If you will build this cantilever from piezoelectric material, you know. The reply is obvious. That's right. Due to the piezoelectricity effect, it is clear that this element will vibrate. That's right.
And the application of some signal.
Correct. But silicon carbide itself is not a piezoelectric material, as well as graphene. So I have to employ external energy to make this element vibrate. Yeah? Okay. Everything should be clear on the spot. Now, coming back to my question. Input, carbon monoxide concentration. What's going on when carbon monoxide molecules will interact with the graphene. Because we have to go, look, engineering way of thinking, we have to go step by step. What will change? First, which parameter will change? The first one, due to this interaction, which one?
Mass will change.
Loudly.
The mass will change.
Mass, perfect. Yeah. That's the reply, yeah? So I'm putting next block, yeah? Absorption. Excellent. Yeah, putting here and here. I have a mass change. That's right. Mass change. Let me think if it's a correct sequence. Mass change. Okay, perfect. Mass change. When the mass will change, what will happen?
And the resonant frequency will change.
Excellent. Yeah, because the situation will be like this, that we'll observe the shift of this from F0 to F0 prime. That's right? And this is my output signal, delta F. That's right? So here I have delta F. Transfer characteristic, frequency shift versus carbon monoxide concentration. But first of all, what is the biggest advantage of this sensing technique? The first of all, I have a direct frequency output signal. Direct. No need for signal processing system. Direct frequency output signal. I already know I can measure frequency very accurately. And I'm happy with this situation. Because this approach gives me excellent sensitivity. Yeah? So this is transduction chain. Now, what will happen in the case of other transducing membrane or diaphragm? Let's discuss this issue quickly. I'm taking silicon substrate, and etching thin membrane. This is membrane. Let's discuss pressure measurement. Let's build this transduction chain for the case of pressure. Very thin membrane. This is silicon material. This is pressure, delta P. I have to measure pressure. So I'm putting first block, delta P. Now, step by step, what's going on? When pressure acts, what will happen? Which parameter will?
The elastic modulus.
This is elastic material, so we'll observe membrane deflection. Deflection, yeah? It will deflect. So we have a deflection. Now, if membrane deflects, let's put the cross-section in this, because most of the pressure sensors for automotive industry currently manufactured in Silicon Valley are this type of sensors. So what they are doing? They are putting so-called, they are putting piezo resistance in a Whitson bridge configuration. Piezo resistance. If it's N-type silicon, piezo resistor is made from P-type silicon. P-type silicon. So, piezo-resistive effect. Piezo-resistive means that if I am applying pressure, I am obtaining resistance change. Piezo-resistance, yeah? Piezo-resistance. So first block, deflection change. Now, next, what will happen if the element is piezo-resistive? Silicon is highly piezo-resistive material. What will happen? Slowly, slowly, step by step. Step by step. This is we cannot miss some transduction. We have to use the right sequence. When the membrane deflection occurs, what I'm causing? Look at this chair. This chair is now living in peace. Yeah? I'm not touching this. When I apply force,
deformation.
What will happen? Deformation, okay, and?
Displacement is stress.
And stress. This is next, yeah? We have to be careful. We have to go step by step. So stress, let's put it, delta sigma, and now, due to the piezo-resistive effect, we have a piezo-resistive element, resistance change, but it's not the end, because if I am using Wheatstone bridge configuration, these piezo-resistors are placed in a proper way, but it's not the major problem at this stage. There will be next
voltage.
That's perfect. Voltage, easy, yeah. So transfer characteristic, voltage versus
pressure,
yeah. So please keep in mind every type of sensor, engineering approach. I know nothing. First step, I'm trying to build transduction chain. This is very basic understanding, transduction chain. I will deliver very nice examples because one lady asked me how to measure heavy metals. So I will deliver you example how to measure mercury concentration in air. Simple approach. Mercury, we'll go through transduction chain. So, concluding, transduction chain, first approach. And having this picture in mind, I'm going deeper and deeper. Yeah? Later, I will learn a little bit physical chemistry or more. I can communicate with physical chemists because they have to understand what I want from them, and I have to understand what I want from them. Yeah? Let me tell you a story. At the beginning of this year, I was invited. This is a big project in Europe, yeah? And they invited me during winter time, snow, very nice landscape. They invited me to act using Latin language as a advocatus diaboli, person, assessor, yeah, external assessor, critical person, looking from outside, assessing the progress of the project. So, but I will complete this story tomorrow, because it's a long story. Thank you very much for your attention. I'm trying to, look, this is my approach, because I tell you something. There are two ways of teaching. One way is like this, recommending textbook and going chapter by chapter. You can do it yourself, yeah? Let me tell you one story quick. This is quick story. It was very good movie, Havana. Robert De Niro played a gambler in this movie. Redford, sorry, you are right.
Not enough coffee.
Robert Redford. And Redford says, I'm not very educated man. I don't know so much, he says. But what I know very well. I like this phrase. And the same story with engineering approach, because we know a little bit. We know a little bit, yeah? We have some engineering background, we have a different, but in this multidisciplinary area, this is very multidisciplinary area, sometimes the situation is very complicated. And I cannot jump into physical chemistry deeply because I have no background. So I have to use the proper approach, engineering approach. And I'm trying to pass this personal experience to you. This is not from the textbook. That's what I believe is good. See you tomorrow at 10 o'clock.